Welcome everyone to Artefacts, Symbols of Labor Rights. I want to start off with thanking Daniel, Tani, and UCLA for including La Plaza in this collaborative series. We hope everyone has found this series informative, and we hope you're ready today to make some art together with us. My name is Gina Alicia Lopez Ramos, Director of Education at La Plaza de Cultura y Artes. Throughout our session today, we will be utilizing the chat feature, so please make sure to add your comments and questions in the chat box. Today's session is a hands-on art making workshop, and you will need some supplies and materials to follow along. A list of recommended supplies is in the chat box now, or we'll be there in just a second, so that you can get your materials ready. So let's begin. For those of you that might not be aware, La Plaza de Cultura y Artes is a cultural museum located in downtown Los Angeles that honors the past, inspires the future, and recognizes the enduring influence of Mexicans, Mexican Americans, and all Latinos and Latinas in Los Angeles. Today's hands-on workshop will be facilitated by our education team members, Erica Garcia and Liz Gama, who you'll get to meet in just a little bit. Together, we will explore historical objects and iconography, or symbols, that are used in protest posters to bring awareness to farm labor rights from both the past and from the present day. We're going to examine this iconography closely and break down symbols and their meanings to us. And together, we're going to make a protest poster to bring attention to farm worker rights. Before we start, let's look closely at the word artifacts, which we selected as the title of our session today. Artifacts, which you might be more familiar with, are objects that have cultural or historical importance or significance. The objects we're going to look at together today transcend beyond a direct human use of them and are represented in art. And so these objects are what we define as artifacts. I also want us to look at the meaning of symbols. Symbols are shapes, signs, or images that represent or stand for something else. Symbols are used to communicate messages without using words. They can be used to bring attention to social causes like women's rights, racial equity, and labor rights, among many other campaigns for social justice. In this manner, symbols transcend linguistic barriers and can be quick identifying markers of an issue, cause, or campaign. We're going to start off today with sharing a visual timeline. And to show you this resource, I introduce to you Erica Garcia.
Thank you, Gina. Hi, folks. As Gina Lisa mentioned, my name is Erica, and I'm the education manager at La Plaza de Cultura y Artes. And I want to thank every single one of you for joining us today on the last legs of this week-long conference. Today we are going to be talking about some of the symbols used by the UFW, otherwise known as the United Farm Workers. But before we get there, I want to briefly share some information to set the time frame and to summarize all the historical factors that might have already been shared throughout the week. So let's jump in. Oh, there we go. It begins in the mid-19th century with the influx of Asian migrants coming from China into the United States to aid in the construction of the Transcontinental Railroad. They quickly became a large part of the workforce, ultimately moving into California where they aided in the foundation of agricultural development. As time passed by, anti-Chinese discrimination laws would be enforced, forcing many Chinese migrants to be deported out of the US and Japanese migrants would be imported to take their place in the workforce. We then see in the years between the 1920s and 1930s, a large wave of Filipino migrants in the US, which was estimated to be around 30,000 migrants. Many coming from agricultural backgrounds gravitated to searching for work in Central California. It was also during this time that we see the organization of another one of the largest strikes and moments in history that was for the rights of farm workers, which is the Pecan Shaler strike of 1933 led by Emma Tenayuca in Texas. Then in the 1940s, World War II began. Because many American citizens were being drafted, the United States developed the Bracero program, which was an exploitative program organized to solve labor shortages. Through this program, thousands of Mexican citizens entered the US on contract to work during harvesting seasons for undercut wages. By the 1960s, farm workers were largely Mexican, Mexican Americans, and Filipino, Filipino Americans, all working low paid and physically demanding agricultural work throughout Central California. Working conditions worsened as farm workers and their families didn't have access to educational and health opportunities, faced discrimination and violence, lived in poverty, worked in unsanitary conditions, and were oppressed when seeking for treatment. By this time, various organizations were beginning to form to fight for the rights of laborers. The AWOC, the Agricultural Workers Organizing Committee, affiliated with the AFL-CIO, was run by activists Dolores Huerta and Larry Etalon. Through the leadership of Larry, many Filipino farm workers already had experience with organizing unions and strikes. Also during this time, Cesar Chavez was organizing the NFWA, the National Farm Workers Association. He was working with farm working families throughout the valley to organize unions. It wasn't until 1966 that the AWOC and the NFWA came together to form the United Farm Workers of America. As a combined organization and through the leadership of Larry, Cesar, and Dolores, among others, they led many marches, strikes, protests, and formed unions and contracts, all for the betterment of farm workers. In present day, the fight for farm workers continues, which is why we're here today, and actually throughout this whole week, to understand that although strides have been made, la lucha sigue. We're here to acknowledge the essential role they provide to not only our economy, but that they're the literal backbones of the food we consume daily, which is easy at times to forget with fast-paced consumerism. So that's our brief history lesson. I will be sharing a virtual timeline with all this information, as well as some additional resources in the chat. If you'd like to explore the history of the UFW further, as well as farm worker rights. And I will also be including resources for educators to use in the classroom. And all of these links, because it is quite a handful, will be added into the chat by the end of our session. That way they're easily accessible for everyone to click on at the end. Now to the fun. We're gonna shift our gears a bit to gear up for the workshop. And we'll start off by examining our first historical object, a flag. So I wanna ask you all a simple question of what do you see? So take your observations, and once you're ready, in about a minute or so, you can go ahead and start writing them in the chat. We'll read some off and then continue on with this little activity. So go ahead and take a good look. And when you're ready, check the chat out. Write it in the chat, not check it out. Cool, I see some folks know what it is already. All right, so I see Laura Lu said eagle, the color red. Mariana said an eagle. Oh gosh, it's going fast now. Michael said a pyramid. Michael's, good job, Michael. Milan said symbol of an eagle. Oh no, I can't see anymore. My mouse went away. Oh, there you go. Marjorie said United Farm Workers flag from the 1960s. Nivia said, I see the word huelga. All great observations, I may say. A black eagle. Diana. Gabriela, the eagle on its wings look like it's making stairways. Y'all are all so smart. Levels, good. Black eagle. All right, a couple more seconds to let everyone write their chat, get access to the chat. If you can't find it, it should be in the lower corner or center. A symbol of hope. Good job, Enrique. Christine said pyramids. Amparo said red, color of unions. Good symbolism there. All righty, so thank you all for participating. Those are all really great observations. Feel free to continue writing them as we continue on throughout this small portion of the activity. So I did see some folks said eagle, some said other things, some pointed out colors, some pointed out the symbolism behind the colors, which is super awesome. We're all on the right track, so good observations. So it is an eagle, as we can see. But before we talk about where it came from, I do wanna ask, what might this eagle represent to you? So think about that question a little bit, and once you're ready, go ahead, write your responses in the chat once again. And again, I will give us all around 1 minute to think and to share. Alexa said liberty. Indira said hope and perseverance. Good. Thanks, Daniel, for rewriting the question. La lucha, being strong, free, liberty and freedom. They're all so nice. Stay strong and united. Strength, courage, good. Oh, Amparo said the eagle on the nopal, a symbol of Mexico. Beautiful connection. Power, good. Couple more seconds for folks. Good, Andrea, same thing. The Mexican flag, which has an eagle at the center, might be alluding to that, which means strength and freedom. Pride and dignity, strength, all great connections. So a couple more seconds to write what this eagle means to you specifically, what it might represent to you. Strength and unity, a lot of strength, pride, dignity, stronger together. That's a nice one, Carlos. All righty, thank you all for sharing once again. I'm glad to hear that for the most part, the eagle represents something positive to the majority of us, which is beautiful. And now we're gonna continue. So as some of you might already know, which I think was already shared in the chat, this particular design is the UFW logo. It was first created in 1962 by Richard Chavez. He was instructed by CESAD to create a symbol of an eagle. His intentions were to create a symbol that could be tied to Aztec history and be a representation of pride and dignity. The story goes that he tried multiple times to draw an eagle they both liked, and on one of his final attempts, this geometric design was a result. First showcased in 1962 for the NFWA, it now represents the UFW organization and its efforts put into fighting, boycotting, and various victories. Although not all were Mexican or Mexican-American, the eagle was used to unify all members across linguistic backgrounds and barriers. It was created using stylized wings, so it'd be easier for union members to replicate onto homemade banners, onto graphics and pins. Give us all a second to look at them before I flip through them. Posters. Clothing. And even a knitted vest that Dolores would wear. As we can see, the symbol of the eagle was used to unify, provide strength, and hope for better conditions. In addition to dissecting the image in its current plane, I also suggest you look at it when inverted. Again, I'd like to ask the simple question of what do you see? So take your observations, and then once again, I'll give you all a minute to write it in the chat. I think a lot of us already kind of knew what it was, referring to the steps, and was already shared in the initial observation. But go ahead and write it once again. Aztec pyramid, the Aztec pyramid, stepping up to the table where we all can sit. Wow, that's a good one. Aztec steps, Aztec pyramid, good. Oh, that's a nice one, Felix. Obstacles to overcome to reach a certain goal. Gabriela said stairways both leading to the center top. Good. I missed some of them earlier, but I want to share them. So someone said strength in striking, stronger together, strength in unity. And I also want to share there is no wrong answer. That's something we always share with our students when we're on site and we're doing workshops. There is no such thing as wrong answers. So please feel free to share whatever your opinion may be, as long as it's respectful in the chat. Enrique said, everything is achieved through steps. Very true. And I'll give everyone a couple more seconds to share what they think this inverted image means, or what they see, I should say. Alrighty, I'm gonna close this chat real quick. So, like some of us already said, we might see a pyramid, others might see a different symbol, but this just goes to show and is an example of how one symbol can have different interpretations and how people can connect to symbols in different ways. So keep that in mind as we continue on through the workshop. But now I'm gonna throw it back to Gina Alicia and she'll explore the concept of artifacts or artifacts further for us.
Okay, so our next object, similar to the UFW flag, also has artistic importance, used in raising consciousness as a symbol of oppression for farm workers. The object you see on your screen is a short-handled hoe. I want you to think about how this tool is used. What position would your body be in if you were using this tool? And think about whether you would be able to walk in that position down long rows in a field and for long periods of time. Farming hoes are one of the oldest agricultural tools used to cultivate or loosen and break up soil, to remove weeds and to thin crops. Thinning means to remove some seedlings or plants in order to allow surrounding plants room to grow. Modern hoes usually have long wooden handles that range from 4 feet to 5 feet long, and that's about 48 inches to 60 inches long, allowing the person using the tool to stand upright without bending over. The short-handled hoe, however, was a hand tool with a handle that ranged between 12 to 18 inches long. It is theorized that the first short-handled hoes made its way to the United States at the end of the 19th century by way of Chinese and Japanese agricultural workers. The short handle of this tool required workers to stoop, bend over the crops from the waist to reach the ground. This position caused crippling lower back pain to farm workers as they worked through long rows of crops, resulting in long-term and in some cases permanent injuries. The short-handled hoe was unique to agricultural labor in California, widely used throughout the state in lettuce, sugar beets, bell peppers, squash, and celery crops. Farm growers throughout the state preferred the use of the short-handled hoe in their fields and demanded that their workers use this tool for two main reasons. One, they believed that by stooping over and being closer to the crops, workers could more quickly and carefully harvest down long rows in a field. Two, it exerted their control over farm workers by allowing farm growers to monitor at a glance whether workers were working or resting. Farm workers standing up to stretch their backs would put themselves at risk of losing their jobs for the day if they were spotted by growers. This made it a tool of oppression for farm workers and an iconic symbol for the struggle for farm worker rights. In California, by the 1960s, many Spanish-speaking agricultural workers referred to the short-handled hoe as el cortito, which means the short one. This tool, along with the unfair treatment and working conditions in agricultural fields, the unprotected illegal status of many workers, and the interests of farm growers, resulted in decades of exploitation for farm workers throughout the state that continues today. Labor leader Cesar Chavez had a personal connection to El Cortito. His father, Librado Hernandez Chavez, owned a short-handled hoe, which is the one you're seeing now on your screen. Librado used this tool throughout his life as a migrant farm worker throughout California's agricultural fields. Cesar was familiar with his father's tool and had in fact inherited it to use during his youth. After his father was injured in an accident, Cesar took to working in the fields. Using his father's short-handled hoe, Cesar thinned and weeded lettuce and sugar beet crops to help his family make ends meet. In interviews collected by journalist Jax E. Levy, Cesar described the short-handled hoe with the following. Every time I see lettuce, that's the first thing I think of. Some human being had to thin it, and it's just like being nailed to a cross. You have to walk twisted as you're stooped over, facing the row and walking perpendicular to it. You're always trying to find the best position because you can't walk completely sideways. It's too difficult. And if you turn the other way, you can't thin. I think this is where the employer shows the most contempt for his workers. For example, I think growers use short-handled hoes because they don't give a damn about human beings. They look at human beings as implements. And if they had any consideration for the torture that people go through, they would give up the short-handled hoe. All that stooping is one reason farm workers die before they're 50. This connects a lot to what we heard yesterday with our speaker, David Bacon, both in regards to harvesting lettuce itself, as well as to the fate of aging farm workers. In 1972, the legal fight to outlaw the use of the short-handled hoe began with an official complaint to the California Division of Industrial Safety. This claim was rejected, and the case was taken to the California State Supreme Court, which overturned the ruling and found that the tool was an unsafe hand tool and a danger to workers' health because it could only be used while stooping. This court ruling, along with advocacy from the United Farm Workers, Governor Jerry Brown, and Cesar Chavez, ultimately succeeded in outlawing the short-handled hoe in California in 1975. Now, let's take a look at this representation of this object in protest art. The image you see on your screen is a protest poster made in 1971 by activist, painter, and muralist Victor Ochoa. This poster demands a change to conditions faced by farm workers and their families, including child labor, infant and maternal mortality rates, as well as growing deaths from accidents, tuberculosis, and influenza that were significantly higher than the national average. It's interesting to think about the statistics presented in this poster in 1971 with national data today, especially as we weather through the COVID-19 pandemic. In the middle, the central image is a farm worker with the cortito in hand, the words venceremos underneath, which means we'll overcome. The two objects we just explored are two historical artifacts from the past. To explore artifacts today, I introduce to you Liz Gama.
Hello, everyone. And again, thank you for joining us. My name is Liz Gama, and I'm the education assistant at La Plaza. Now that both Erica and Gina Alicia have shown us how artifacts became symbols of labor rights, I will be shifting gears and sharing how other symbols may represent labor rights in art today. Pictured here are two pieces of art by Narciso Martinez. In his works, Easy Grape and In the Fresh, we see produce boxes used as canvases, painted with portraits of farm workers against agricultural landscapes. But why produce boxes? Well, if you think about it, the fruits and vegetables that are placed in these boxes are harvested by the hands of farm workers. These boxes are often branded with company labels, but we don't see who does all the hard work. Let's take a look at another artist. These are Trabajadora Esencial and America's Essential Workers by Cristi Tirado. When looking at these two prints, pay close attention to the clothing that is being worn, tools that are being used, the poses and body language, and if you can find any written words. Go ahead and share your findings in the chat. I'll give you a minute to do so. Yeah, somebody found the words essential. Any other things you may notice? Essential, very good. Tirado's work is beautiful. Thank you, Jimena. Gabriela also said essential. Essential, yes. All right, let's go ahead and look. Oh, the details, it looks like they're concealing something. The red apples contrast with the black and white, Oliver Jose said. Andre Antonio, the crops on the right are very detailed. The rays behind the woman make her look like the Madonna, said Dawn. Amazing graphics. Awesome. Sweat and blood into every bushel. Amazing graphics. Good. Thank you. Okay, let's take a look at another artist. What's the chat? Here we see the profile portraits of farm workers portrayed in a completely different style. In his works titled Heroes Feeding America 1 and 2, Jorge Garza uses art found in codices as a source of inspiration. Codices are ancient manuscripts that talk about life long ago. Jorge Garza was inspired by how gods were posed in the codices and drew essential farm workers in a similar style. Let's take a look at one more. This piece you might recognize from the conference flyer. This is called Unwavering Resilience by Blanca Molina. Here we see the silhouette of a person against a dark orange background surrounded by many symbols, including fire. Works of art like this show us how farm workers continue to work regardless of harsh climate conditions. This piece is by artist Ernesto Llerena. Here we see the representation of many symbols. Using the chat, share what other symbols you find and what they might represent to you. Oh, somebody said Black Lives Matter, Sacred Heart, Si Se Puede. Thank you, Andrea. Thank you, Laura. Thank you, Alexis. Black Lives Matter. Si Se Puede. Lucha. Oh, it's going fast. Dora Luz, thank you. Larry, Black Lives Matter. Gabriela, Black Lives Matter. UFW said Brandon Hurtado. Whenever I see a rose, I think of the rose that grew in the concrete. Nivea, good observation and good connection. The right said Diana Diaz. Amparo said having ganas and heart. The Sacred Heart of Jesus, Rose La Raza is Si Se Puede, hand raised. Good observation, Marjorie. Awesome. I'm gonna close the chat. So to me, the eagle represents resistance and perseverance. Links to all the artists' websites and social medias will be included in the chat at the end of our workshop, and make sure to check them out. Well, now that we have looked at some artwork with examples of symbols and the importance of them, let's make our own. As previously mentioned, symbols are shapes, signs, or images that represent something else. As we examined previously, the eagle is a symbol of the UFW, and the short-handled hoe can be interpreted as a symbol of the oppression farm workers faced on the fields. In art today, we see the eagle, connections to Mesoamerica, symbols representing food, symbols of tools that are used, and the symbol for the right, and the symbol for the fist of resistance. What other symbols do you see? Share in the chat below. Any other ones that you may have seen? Oh, I missed some from the previous. Treat people kindly. Awesome, Diana. Any other symbols you might have seen throughout any of the images that we just saw? Pyramids, awesome, Amparo. I have never seen the bonfire, Awesome, Brianna. Give you a couple more seconds. Strong, be brave, said the Maris. Thank you. Fruits and veggies, said Alexandra Guzman. Awesome. Okay. I saw symbols of fire and masks, which could be interpreted as the harsh working conditions farm workers still face and the scarce access to personal protective equipment. It is symbols like these that show us how essential farm workers are. Symbols have been used to communicate labor rights and a call to action, to inspire and encourage people to learn more and become involved. Before we begin our art activity, let's take a moment to think about what other symbols communicate labor rights to you. Feel free to share some of those in the chat. Any other symbols that might represent labor rights to you? The fruit crate, said Brianna C. Yes. Fist of resistance. Thank you, Erica. Awesome. For today's workshop, we will be creating a protest poster. If you haven't already, go ahead and grab some materials. On the screen is a suggested list of materials you could use. We'll give you a moment to gather them. I'll also include them in the chat for you. Oh, I missed a comment. Somebody said gloves or any tools they use on the farm. Very good, Andrea Antonio, thank you. Okay. All right, Ms. Erica. All right, let's begin. We are going to start our workshop by drawing a symbol that represents labor rights to you. Think of the symbol that we just think of the symbols that we just explored together. Draw and design your symbol in the middle of your paper. This can be any symbol, as this will be your poster and your interpretation. I will be drawing the symbol of an eagle. I will turn on my overhead camera, and you are welcome to follow along. This is going to be just like an old school art class, so go ahead and get creative.
Does the size matter?
The size does not matter. It can be as big or as small as you want on the center of your paper. Any questions before we begin, maybe? Nivia?
Just to clarify, is it on the bold paper or is it on the cardboard or just like another paper?
It's going to go on your sheet of paper.
Oh, okay.
And then at the end, we'll glue it onto our cardboard. Any other questions?
Thank you.
Awesome. Great, let me scroll through just to make sure nobody's raising their hand. No, okay. If any questions, just throw them down in the chat. Awesome. Okay. In the meantime, Erica will play for us some beautiful music of the movement from the album Si Se Puede from the 1970s. Hit it, Ms. Erica.
Mm-hmm.
All right. For those of you who have cardboard, you're welcome to glue on your symbol. And as we wrap up, start to think about a slogan you can incorporate to express the importance of labor rights. A slogan is a short phrase that can be one word and used to raise awareness and bring people together under one message. Feel free to share one in the chat. Some examples of slogans are huelga, strike, si se puede, yes we can, la lucha sigue, the fight continues, and farm workers are essential.
Thank you.
Although we are running out of time, I would like to encourage you all to finish your protest poster by adding the slogans you brainstormed. Make sure to display your finished protest poster on your lawn or window, or share with your friends and family. I would like to invite everyone to hold up their protest poster and share with us in the chat what you designed. I'll share mine. As we're looking at these, educators, think about how this activity could be adapted in the classroom. Students, think about all the messages that are important to you that you can share through art. Thank you all for participating. I'm going to throw it back to Daniel for some closing remarks, and I will be sharing resources in the chat. Thank you.
Thank you, Liz. Let's give it up for Liz, Gina, Alicia, and Erica. It was an amazing presentation. Thank you so much for walking us through that. That was beautiful.